When the floor gets dusty, when your blade gets rusty, with a shins, when your broom smells funny, when a hex takes your money, what's gonna save you, honey? Just with a shins, all you witches, and all your old magicians.
Finally come to an end. The Breeders on Waiters in the Radio. I think we heard The Dam before that, and the Derek Calmore Orchestra with the Wittishins theme song.
I believe that was it.
I believe that's all we played there. Okay, perfect. Well, as you are all avid listeners of the show, you know that we are deep in the throes of the WitchCon Marathon. It's a crazy thing that we've done for 3 years now, where shortly before WitchCon, we do broadcast pretty much almost every day, sometimes a couple times a day.
The WitchCon Marathon. We're even willing to do it on a weekend for
even
y'all.
Even working weekends, evenings, mornings. Today was kind of early. I mean, we barely had our coffee.
We're going to have another early one soon.
Yep. Yeah. But so if you're not following the program, whatever format you're on, iHeartRadio or iTunes or Google Podcasts or all the goddamn places where you are, there's got to be a follow button or a subscribe button. You want to follow and subscribe because we don't even know what our schedule is yet. We're just slowly hooking people up. Charity, we knew about like 2 weeks in advance. Some people, it's like we know like 24 hours before they're going to be on.
Well, you know me. I'm keeping everything organized in a file with the names and the times and the dates and stuff. But I just started doing that.
But tonight, we got Charity Bedell again. She's been on the show before. I think it was WitchCon last year or the year before.
Hello.
Hello. How are you?
Hi. It was 2 years ago. It was the first year of WitchCon, and I believe it was either right after or right before.
Okay.
Yeah. And she's got a new book out, Container Magic. I just finished it myself. And you, before we even start, I know we got a lot of you TikTok witches listening to the show. You want this book. Just want this book. This is like all the stuff. I know you said that you got a TikTok channel and haven't put anything on there. These are the kind of spells that are all the rage for all the kids on TikTok. Jar spells and sachets and containers. Containers, basically. It's Container Magic by Charity Bedell. Just came out. Spellcraft using sachets, bottles, poppets, and jars. Y'all love that.
Yeah.
I'm sure lots of other witches love that too, but I specifically know that my TikTok audience wants this book. I know you guys don't like books. You know, maybe she'll do an audio book soon.
Yeah, that's
but read a goddamn book, okay? Okay, Charity, back to you.
Thanks. I mean, now that book was a lot of fun to write, and honestly, for a lot of people, it's Container Magic is probably the best form of magic for them to work because it's easy, it can be discreet, and it's something that you can basically carry with you everywhere.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I did note you had a protection bottle spell that I would say is drastically like a witch's bottle, but you used your saliva instead of urine. You know which one I'm talking about? Other than that, it was very much like a witch's bottle. It's got pins. You know, pins are always an important part of it. I don't remember all the ingredients that he had in there. There was several different herbs. I believe, was it comfrey? God, it was something for the dead. God, I can't think of the herb. Starts with a P. People use it for money. And they use it for lust. A patchouli.
Okay.
I can't believe I forgot that one because, you know, the hippies in Santa Cruz, they all love their patchouli oil.
Yep.
Yeah, I recall that one specifically. That was interesting. So when did the book come out? Recently, right?
Yeah, it actually just was released at the very beginning of the month. January 8th was the official date on Amazon, and It's been flying out of Amazon. I check periodically, and two or three times I've seen only 4 copies of the book left. Get it now.
So. Nice. Does your publisher handle all the Amazon listing stuff, or you got to do that?
My publisher handles that. Llewellyn does that. So okay. That's.
So yours is probably done correct. We had a friend of ours on, and he's another publisher, and you can get it through Amazon. And then somebody commented on the show, said we can't get that on Amazon UK. So apparently he had to go in and do something. But you know, if you got your publisher handling it, I'm sure they probably did it correctly. But he could have been selling in the UK all this time, didn't know, but until somebody commented on the show.
Cheese stick.
Yeah.
So how long has this book been in the making? Have you been thinking about it for a while?
There were parts I started writing years ago when I was just really starting to get confident in myself and was thinking about putting on my blog. Mm-hmm. But in seriousness, the book was probably, it actually started right around the first WitchCon is when I first started working on it in earnest. Mm-hmm. And then I submitted it to my publisher and they accepted it. And now I'm selling that, and I have a couple others that I'm hoping to submit in the next several months and hopefully have more books out there soon.
Nice. Mm-hmm. You mentioned in our text that you might be at Hexfest.
Yes. Christian Day has actually been trying to get me down to Hexfest for like the last 4 years.
Well, let me tell you, you are on the schedule for next year.
We checked.
Yeah.
They haven't really gotten back to us on whether our workshops were accepted, but we went and looked at the schedule, and you're on there. So get ready.
Yeah, I'm excited about it, but also kind of nervous because I know it's a huge event, and I have had friends go, and they loved it, so.
It'll be great. It'll be great. Nothing like Hexfest. I mean, it's, you know, we start with that riverboat ritual. I know we're not going to talk about Hexfest tonight, but, you know, we'll probably have you on again before that. But, yeah, it just, you know, it starts with that riverboat ritual, and then we all just take over this town. I mean, this town is so full of witches anyways, but just three times as much on Hexfest weekend. It's crazy. It's great. A lot of fun.
Yep. Yeah, well, I finally decided to be like, okay, I just got my first solo book released. Yeah. Let's do it.
Yep, you got to beat them feet. Get that book out there in front of people. Your publisher's been very, this is the first time we actually went through a publisher. They've been very helpful, I got to say. We usually just talk to the
Charity,
people directly.
You're on August 12th, August 13th, and, well, you actually have two on August 13th.
Oh, yeah. They fly you in, they get...
Just FYI. Yeah.
When they fly you in, you got to do three workshops.
Yep.
Is there a panel? A lot of times they give you a panel, too.
I don't know if he's figured out the panel yet.
Okay. Yeah, so check the schedule.
Yeah, I might have to do a panel.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think he works that out a little later.
Yeah.
But you're on for three.
Well, it's a blast, and, you know, every time you get paid, you know, that just makes you more of a professional witch. That's your job. It's a good job to have.
It is a good job. It's also a lot more hard work than people want to realize.
I totally get it. People have been on me for like decades to write a book. And it's just like, you know what? I am not an author.
Back in the day, it was Publisher Parrish.
Publisher Parrish used to be the way. And it's like, I'm a teacher. And I have learned a lot of stuff over a lot of years. But if I have to write a book, I've got to remember where all of those things that are in my brain came from. I have to have references and shit. I can't remember. I remember everything I ever read about witchcraft, but not where I read it.
Start jotting things down. I will have to jot things down. Of a,
I think for me, I need to just talk and have a scribe. I'm not an author. I think authors are authors, teachers are teachers, priests and priestesses are priests and priestesses, and not anybody is going to have all of those skills, unless you're like Lou.
No. Can you hear my headset's acting weird?
Yeah, you sound great.
Yeah.
Okay. It blanked out there for a second. No, I actually knew I wanted to be a writer, hopefully for Llewellyn, since I was like 13 years old and read my first book on witchcraft. And it was just, there was a calling deep within my soul because I already loved writing. And then I didn't like, this is what you're supposed to be doing. So,
is that about when you started practicing around age 13?
when I was 13, I got my very first book, Witchcraft, which was Teen
Witch.
Uh-huh. Raven Wolf.
Yeah. I sold a lot of
it
those.
It was a wonderful birthday present.
Yeah, I'm not. Wait.
Oh, yeah.
She was at Hexfest last year, right?
Who?
Was that Ravenwolf?
I know she was at WitchCon.
Maybe it was WitchCon.
I don't know. I confuse the two sometimes. Yeah.
There's somebody else that I'm thinking of. There's so many big names at these things. I mean, I don't know if you've looked at the schedule for WitchCon. It's just amazing some of the people we're on the same stage with.
Occasionally.
It's kind of overwhelming when you see it. It might give you cold feet. Don't look. Look later.
Yeah, look at it after you're done.
After the
What I do love is that there are so many names on there that, you know, I might have seen an article from here or there, but they haven't been seen as much as some of the other people. So it's giving other people a good chance to come out about WitchCon. It's a great chance for people to start and learn a lot.
Yeah, I was just talking about that. There's such a great diversity. Like, there's people that, you know, most people haven't heard of. And then there are people like Silver Ravenwolf.
Yeah. We got, Priestess Miriam.
Yeah.
For we still don't know who the official voodoo queen of New Orleans is at this time, but she's definitely in the running. And I've never seen her teach anywhere on anything. She doesn't leave her temple often, they say. So that's pretty impressive. I mean, for me, that's impressive. But then there's, big name authors on there and stuff. The BNPs, the big name pagans, man.
Yeah.
They're all there. And it's like, so those of you who don't know, man, 60 or 95 bucks.
Yep.
For close to 100 witches.
Roughly 100 people.
Yeah, almost 100 witches. And we have not finished watching the stuff from 3 years ago. And 2 years ago, I'm even backlogged on that. But you have access to them forever. Yep. It can be like an online video library of the coolest magic. You can be a solitaire and just study WitchCon. You probably know a lot of stuff, man.
Yeah, I mean, I'm still going back and watching stuff I haven't seen, and there are a couple that I'm rewatching constantly because I'm like, there's so much in this. I got to pick out all the details. It's if I couldn't go back and rewatch them, I'd miss a lot.
Yeah, and we took them on the laptop, plugged the laptop into the big screen TV, watched them big screen.
Yep.
That's probably
that sounds like fun.
And then I typically do it. I just do it from my phone now. I remember the first year Christian Day was really hardcore about having a hard line connection. I had this big wire running across the living room. Marta hated that thing, and it was unnecessary. It was my phone does fine. The Wi-Fi is like 5 feet from it.
You always have to drag my name into that.
Yeah, well, it was you were. You think I cared? I didn't care that there was a wire on the damn ground. That's wife stuff, man. I'm sorry. We're just over here bickering amongst ourselves. Keep talking.
I really love WitchCon, and it was basically having done it the first year, I am so happy to be coming back, and I'm learning so much. I'm meeting a lot of people, and it's just... there's just so much in there. Even some things that I might have never thought about taking a class in or learning.
Yeah.
There's stuff there. I'm like, oh, I never thought of looking at this. Okay, click, watch.
Yeah, we were just speaking to Caroline Tully yesterday, and I've never heard of her, and her workshop sounds like something I'm definitely going to be at.
Yeah.
So you learn a lot about people who you never would have come across before.
Yeah, that Zoom meet and greet thing, that's fun.
Yeah.
That's fun. Have a blast on that.
Yep.
And it's one of the good things that came out of COVID. It's like some people don't remember. It's like that's how WitchCon started, because we needed to have our gatherings and our festivals and we couldn't. And that year Hexfest was digital too.
Yep.
And WitchCon just keeps going on and on. And the people you can get that can't travel to the United States. You know, since it's remote, you get some really incredible names.
Yeah, like scheduling conflicts or, you know, some disability or whatever reason. You don't have to worry about everybody being in one place at the same time. Yeah, go on.
Yeah, I have a lot of that can't travel for some reason.
Yeah.
And one or two of them, I'm like, oh no, you should check out WitchCon. It's a little pricey, but it's worth it. You'll learn a lot, and you'll be able to go back and watch it as long as you want. So.
Yeah, and when you break it down for what you're getting, it's actually
it's like a buck
very
a presenter.
Affordable. Yeah.
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 And I would think that all of us are worth more than a dollar. And you've got, so since then, you've probably got a couple books out. I know you have another book that come out after the last WitchCon, or the first one that you did?
The first book I did came out in 2017, so just a little bit before COVID. And I wrote that with Sean Robbins, and it was a great way to start. And I really enjoyed writing it because I am very passionate about herbal medicine and herbal magic. It's something that I know a lot about. Mm-hmm. And I keep constantly learning new things.
Yeah.
Oh, that's new.
Can, well, speaking of which, because this is kind of new to me, can you tell us a little bit about ball charms from your book? I'm flipping through it now.
Yes. Ball charms are something that they've been around forever, actually. But a lot of people have started to make them very pretty and do beautiful pictures on Instagram for, like, wishes and things like that. And while they're pretty, that's not really how a ball charm works. They can be made out of mud and dirt. They can be made out of the little plastic ornament, Christmas ornament balls, or you can make one out of making a yarn ball. And they're stuffed and filled with the various curios, herbs, crystals, animal parts like dirt dauber's nest or red fire ants or a shed snake skin. You put them in the ball and then you charge it in some way. I like to shake mine and mix them, and while I shake the ball, I am distributing a bunch of different energy, and that energy is then kept in the ball. And then I put the, if I'm using the plastic balls, I'll put the lid back on and find a little hanger and hang it someplace in the house and let it do its magic. And then all I have to do to keep it active is once a week play with it and focus on what its job was. It could have been for a peaceful home, could be for protection, money, whatever I was doing it for.
And you can probably just hang it right in your closet.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
If you wanted to. Yeah. Great.
Well, here's another one that caught my eye, the Pet's Witch's Jar. Tell us a little bit about that. I don't see enough stuff done for our pets, you know. We used to make these protective mojo bags for pets, and they would go, like, on their collar and stuff. I don't see enough stuff like that, so.
Now, it kicked me thinking that you can include, you know, your pets in your normal witch's jar for the home and family, because I do that, too. But one of the things I have learned over the years is that one of the first things people to be affected if I was to have negative or baneful magic cast at me, if it doesn't hit me, it might actually hit my pets first. So I'm thinking, you know, I should probably make something just for them too. Yeah, and that's where the idea of the that switches Dara Combs in, so it gives them that extra level of protection, and it just also gives, ends up providing me a little extra level protection because I'm not worried about stuff designed to hit me hitting them instead, and I'm not worried about someone trying to get to me by getting to them instead.
Absolutely. Yeah. Not enough people think about that. It's like the canary in the coal mine thing. You know, you're going to protect your kids and stuff. So these, you know, these are a lot of people's kids. Before we had kids, these were the kids.
My three cats are my babies.
Absolutely. Yep. Well, just on that note, what do you think about familiars? A lot of debate about that out there.
Well, in my view, if it eats, shits, and sleeps, and has a has an actual physical body you can touch and hold, it's not a familiar. They can be a spiritual friend and a great ally, but they are not a familiar. Familiars are spirits. They can take an animal form, but they are not actually physical animals. And when people say that their pets are their familiars, it kind of makes me wince, because one of the familiars' job is to take magical hits for their witch. And I don't want my pets doing that.
We've winced before, too.
This is my whole problem with that. Well, and, you know, the typical... familiars come to us more through ceremonial magic. It's more of their thing. It gets attached to witches during the times of persecution, because every witch must have a familiar. That's what the Burning Times document said, the Malleus Maleficarum and all that. And in ceremonial magic, you're enslaving that spirit. You torture that spirit into agreeing to become your slave. I don't think most witches really want to do that to Fluffy.
Yeah.
And Fluffy would be really mad and shit on your pillow.
At the very least.
I mean, I have pets that have passed on that I know I can ask their spirit to, you know, look after. But that's not the same as saying they're my familiar, because they're making that choice to still be with me and still help me, because of we want to be with you, we'll help you. Especially the dog I grew up with, I can still feel on me regularly, checking on me, especially when I'm having days where I'm feeling down in the dumps.
They know that shit. Absolutely.
Yeah,
I remember one time Marta banged her nose on something, and the cat slept on her face, purring.
Yeah, he never purred does the that. Entire time. Like, he's
healed that.
I almost broke my nose, and he slept on my nose, like, very lightly, and just purred all night.
Well, they have actually found that there is a people are like, oh no, that's just cat owner mythology.
No, it's true.
They have actually found scientific evidence that proves that the frequency of a cat's purr offers healing, not just to them, but to the people around them.
Absolutely.
Physical and mental, emotional and spiritual.
Absolutely.
It's actually 60 hertz.
Oh, I thought it was 50.
No, 60 hertz, and it can even mend broken bones.
Mend broken bones faster than,
And the thing I find fascinating is, like, it's the vibration, not necessarily just the frequency, but the vibration and the frequency causes that to happen, and that's just what cats are doing. They're just vibrating. They're vibrating this magical frequency at us, you know. Sabo, where are you?
Oh, there he goes. We
have a blind
His
cat
ears
that
are
sometimes gets lost, and I have to go fetch him.
Yeah, he's about 18. He's older than our son. And, he started losing his vision recently. I'll get him.
Okay. Yes. Sometimes you need a little help getting over here.
I have an 18-year-old cat that's living with my parents at the moment. She's been living with them for most of her life because I couldn't keep her for many years, and people can't believe that she's 18. She's like, no, she's only like 10. Nope, she's 18 years old. I got her in 2005, and she was only 6 months old when I got her in that August. So,
yeah, this one's our my first black cat is a witch. My whole witch life, I went to get black cats many a times. I always fell in love with a tabby at the rescue place and brought them home. But Sabo actually came into my witch store one day.
Yep.
There was somebody working there that was doing feral rescue, and I relieved them for lunch, and they failed to tell me that this bin on the floor was full of kittens. And I could hear noises. I popped this thing open, and all these kittens came bounding out. There was Sabo. Yeah, he's a sweet guy. He's been with us a long time through a lot of stuff. But in the Malleus Maleficarum, which is where they get the idea that witches had familiars, there's also this one just banal paragraph which just kind of stands out on its own, almost like somebody else wrote it. But it talked about how our ancestors first spotted the witch. And it said they speak in peaceful tones and treat animals as equals and speak to them as such. And I think that's always been the way. We've always had animal partners, animal friends. We witches tend to form a bond with animals different than, you know, regular people. But it's not the same thing as a familiar. And people just really don't understand the language.
No, like I had a cat I had to put down right in the middle of COVID. He was about 17, 18 when we had to put him down. And he was my healing partner. Mm-hmm. He was a cat that had his own natural healing energy that whenever I went to go do Reiki on myself or on my partner, he would show up, lay down, and put his paw out right next to my hands, and he would lend his own natural healing energy to it. And it was like, they have their own, they can have their own energy and spiritual work that doesn't have to make them a familiar. There are other things they can teach us.
Yeah. Yep. Actually, my cats always seem kind of busy with their own spiritual work. They're off doing stuff. They're on the astral plane doing shit all the damn time. But yeah, a familiar is like a servant. I don't want my pets to be servants.
No, if anything, we're their servants.
Absolutely. Yeah. That makes more sense.
No, one of the things I say as I refer to things is dogs are for people who don't mind waiting on someone and having to be caught and having for people that will always, it's like, they demand being fed. It's like,
absolutely. But they say that when people have passed away and, you know, nobody found them for a couple weeks, if they have dogs, the dogs lay down next to them and die. And if they have cats, the cats eventually eat them.
Yep.
I would rather my animals eat me, and, you know, hopefully somebody will find them by then. They'll survive.
Yep.
Then, you know, that's just, I admire the loyalty of a dog, but that's just too far, dude. I don't want you to die for me.
They have my permission to eat me if they need to.
Yeah. Eat me, bitch.
No, I know they would probably go a day or two before they would go make sure they would be extremely hungry and there would have to be no other food for them before they would do that. But yeah, I know very well that if something were to happen to me and there was no food around, but I was dead, I would be my cat's food.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm perfectly fine with that. Like,
so am I.
If I'm gone, then let my body nourish them so they may live.
Yep, absolutely, absolutely. So you want to talk a little bit about your workshop in WitchCon?
So since my first solo book is on container magic, I'm doing a workshop that kind of does a brief overline of some of the material in the book. I'm going to cover a lot of what the first chapters are, but just in a shorter session so that people will still go out and buy and read the book. But I'm going to teach people how to properly choose the container, how to choose their materials for the spells. Mm-hmm. One of the most important part is the feeding of it and making sure that it's still activated. Uh-huh. And then also disposing, because first time I did a jar, it worked, not how I expected it to work, but it did work. And I left the jar sitting for months after it had worked magic, uh-huh. not knowing how do I deal with this? How am I supposed to dispose of this? Because I had no instruction on that before, and I, through trial and error, I figured out, okay, this is how you do this. This is how you can dispose of this material, so I don't have to worry about any remaining energetic ties.
Yeah.
Okay, that's good to know. I think I'll include that information mm-hmm. for people.
Yeah. Well, I just wanted to ask you, do you personally have a favorite type of container that you like to use? Like, be it a jar or a sachet or poppet? Are you, like, partial to any one of those?
I'm actually partial to making packets, which I like to make paper packets.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Because there was a time when I was living in a group home, and the only materials I could have to work with were I had holiday wrapping paper and wrapping ribbon because we had just had the holidays.
Uh-huh.
And I had paper, and I had pen, and I had some colored pencils because we were allowed to have crafting stuff, but I didn't have any herbs or anything. My supplies were limited. Mm-hmm. So I sat down, and I don't remember what exactly it was, but I wrote down a petition. I said a prayer mantra as I was writing it down. I folded the paper several times, then I just started wrapping and tying, getting into a trance and directing that energy. And then I kept tied the final knot, and I kept the little packet I had made. I kept in my, played with it in my, ran it between my fingers.
I'm sorry.
A couple times every day until it worked. And
sorry,
that was the first.
We missed. Sorry, the word. We cut out for
you
just
cut
a
out. So where did you say you kept it?
Kept it.
Oh, they really don't want
okay,
to
it doesn't
want
to...
They don't want us to know that.
It doesn't
part.
Want us
it's
to know where you
right
kept
there.
It. Okay, one more time.
My wallet.
There you go.
Okay.
You got it.
Okay. Got it.
Well, I remember when we were we were studying at Lucky Mojo once upon a time, and they had a similar thing. They made these little envelopes to hold, like, powders and stuff like that. Yep. And I'm looking at it, I'm going, you know, I'm a kid from the 80s. It's like, that's what we used to put Coke in. So I totally knew how to do that.
Yeah.
Right away. And nothing falls out. But a definitely similar thing. You put them in your shoe or your wallet, or depending on what you're doing, mm-hmm. kind of thing.
I mean, if you don't have a wallet, you can put them in your in a pants pocket. If you have a purse, you can keep a purse. And I mean, if you can't carry something with you, then you can have it be like a jar you leave at home, but then you still just keep it activated. Because mm-hmm. that's one of the things I noticed about container magic is that you can basically take any one of the spells in that book and just change the container, and it will still work.
Hmm. That's cool.
Because, I mean, they're all basically, they all do the same thing. They're all vessels for holding the magic until it manifests. Yeah. And once they manifest, the spell is done. Hmm.
Very cool, very cool.
Yep.
Looked like you were going to say something.
Oh, no, I was just thinking to myself, I was thinking about, like, when you do it with paper, do you eventually, like, when you're done with it, do you eventually burn the paper? Or are you, like, always keeping that particular thing in your wallet or what have you?
If I can burn it, I try to burn the paper. If not, I unwrap it and thank the energy.
Yeah.
And basically do a version of a cut and clear with releasing the energy. And just like, unwrap it, you're free. Thank you, you're free. Thank okay. you, mm-hmm. you're free. This has come to pass.
Okay.
Yes. I was always taught, you know, my witch mother said, you know, that which can be burned, that's left over from the spell, should be burned, and that which can't should be buried. I've often thought of some of the things that I've buried. Archaeologists are going to have an interesting time if we're all doing that.
Yeah.
Burying jars and stuff. I mean, they yeah. still find witches' bottles and stuff in England. But, yeah, they're just going to find all kind of weird little trinkets and
yep.
skull candles.
yep. We're going to be in the history books.
Yeah, be trying to figure out what the fuck were these people doing.
Well, I mean, it's interesting because what are archaeological finds but
yep.
someone's old trash?
Yes.
Yep. Yep.
Absolutely. Yep. Yeah, I think of the stuff we bury. We bury trash.
yeah.
Landfills. That's
yep.
what they are.
Yep. Yeah, somebody's going to look at it a million years from now if we're still even, you know, on this planet and be like,
they'll be trying to figure out the religious significance of an old microwave.
Yep. Yep. Plastic.
Plastic. let's see. I never even went to WitchCon.
Oh,
so
yeah.
So what's your workshop?
Oh, we were just talking about
that. I just covered that on container magic.
Okay, I'm sorry. I stepped
magic.
Out for a second.
Well, it's
okay,
basically
so
the
magic.
Different types of containers you can use
right.
the magic.
Well, I think yeah, it's time
to... I'm basically
going
to go over a couple of different types of the container magic, and I'm hopefully going to have a spell to go with each of the types so that I leave them with something they can do right then and there as an example of, this is this type of container, here's this spell. Because
mm-hmm.
when I did that with the aromatherapy and the dirts, people seemed to really like the, okay, here's the information on how this stuff works. Now, here is... example of this one. This is what you need to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Do it.
Cool. All right. Well, I think it's time for us to read the thing.
Okay. Read the thing.
Bring the magic to you. March 3rd to the 5th, 2023, join the largest live stream magical conference in the world, featuring nearly 100 witches and conjurers on live video across the globe. Watch classes live and then rewatch on demand as many times as you like, years later, like we're doing. WitchCon presenters are the preeminent masters of the magical arts and hail from across the rainbow spectrum of occult and spiritual practices. Registration is limited to 1,000 attendees and includes all live classes, rituals, and performances, as well as access to recordings of every class after the event has ended via our on-demand library, so you won't miss a single moment. Now, you haven't been to Hexfest. I'm sure you've been to other festivals, but that's always the problem. You know, my workshop will be during somebody else's workshop I want to see, or somebody
yeah.
I want to see is going to have a workshop.
Absolutely.
I'm going to miss somebody's goddamn workshop.
Yep.
And that doesn't happen
yep.
at WitchCon. And kids... I need you to listen to the first part. 1,000 attendees. Now, of course, our host, Christian Day, is on one of his fabulous vacations. We're all looking at his pictures on Facebook. But right before he left, he told me we were close to that threshold. So we're doing these interviews anyways.
And he, has to cap it at 1,000.
Has to cap it.
Yep.
But I think, you know, if there's like hundreds of people that still want to go, he'll just buy a server. And hook it up. Get some more bandwidth. Pay for some more bandwidth. Yeah. Attendees and fans will love the shopping in our virtual Vendorium, featuring powerful ritual tools, signed books, exquisite jewelry, and handmade spellcrafts. Our virtual meet and greet lets attendees and fans alike meet and chat with presenters live on Zoom, and it's a great way to get to know your favorite teachers. WitchCon Online is live streamed on the Hex Education Network on Crowdcast, a web-based platform with no need to download an app. It runs very smoothly, and it's great. We use it for all kinds of stuff. And Charity L. Bedell's going to be there talking about container magic. What else can you tell us about your workshop without giving us too much about your workshop? Charity.
I didn't hear that. I'm kind of in a daze.
Okay. We were asking, what else can you tell us about your workshop without giving away too much?
I'm going to try to focus. One of the focuses of this class is how magic should be something that you can do with everything, anything you find in your day-to-day life. Anything, you should be able to pick up a soda bottle and then look at the herbs in your kitchen and know, oh, I can cast a spell here.
Yep.
And that's one of the things.
Absolutely.
That's one of the focus, because I find too many people are like, but I don't have this. I don't have this. How can I get this? I'm like,
yeah, I'm a huge proponent of using what you got.
Kitchen cabinet and your spice rack.
Yep.
Absolutely. Yep. Well, I saw this woman on TikTok the other day. She was saying she doesn't like to use the spices in her spice rack. And she showed a jar of cloves. So I don't like to use these when I can just harvest these. And she's harvesting clovers.
Oh, God.
I was just like, I don't even want to like respond to this, man. I'm just... I feel like I'm ragging on somebody, but oh my God, I'm face palming over here.
I mean, clover has its place, but
yes,
it's not cloves.
Cloves.
Yeah, that's funny.
Clover and clove are not the same.
No,
they're opposites. Absolutely,
nope.
Absolutely. Clover cools.
Yeah.
Clove heats. Yep. Absolutely opposites.
That's funny.
Wow. So you're teaching some spice cabinet magic.
That's going to be the focus, and thankfully my family members have always had, and my husband's family, my mother-in-law, my husband, and my mom have always had rather extensively stocked kitchen cabinets, so I'm going to be able to go through and make a list and be like, okay, this is common, this is probably common, this is probably common. Not quite as common, but also easy to find.
Yeah.
And try to focus on that. Like, I'm obviously salt. Those are obvious because those are pretty much everywhere. But there are other ones like coriander, cayenne pepper, dill.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, cinnamon. Cinnamon
so,
can be
lots of different things to look at.
Like the powdered cinnamon in the cabinet makes a fine incense. You just kind of pinch the powder together. It good for money, raises the spiritual vibrations. Mix that with some allspice. You got even better money
and
incense.
It's a heating agent,
so it can
speed things up too.
There's so much in the cabinet. Sometimes, you know, I rag on people. Matter of fact, I got a big controversy going on TikTok right now. We're calling it Candlegate 2.0, where, you know, I said that, you know, using candles from like the dollar store and Walmart, being that they're made in sweatshops, doesn't have a good effect on your magic. And people called me an elitist. I'm going, oh, well, I'm not saying you have to like go out and buy expensive shit. Part of the whole point was do it yourself. Do it yourself. You can make candles. It's not that hard. But the stuff in your kitchen, man, we have like most of the main stuff. Like we tend to have basil, cinnamon, allspice,
pepper,
salt, pepper, various pepper powder,
rosemary.
Rosemary. I mean, that's a whole magical supply cabinet right there.
Yeah, rosemary is one of my favorites.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's basically got everything. It's got protection. It's got peace. It's got meditative and psychic properties. There's, I think, success. You can basically use it for absolutely everything.
Yeah.
Rosemary is, there's a reason why it's primarily, it's the herb I use for all my workings that primarily deal with home and family, because that is one of its primary focuses.
I mean, cooking, you can add it to everything you make.
Well, and I believe in your book, I think it was a study in sense, there's rosemary, ginkgo, and a couple other things, but they all made sense. Mm-hmm. That's a classic study incense. Anything for study, a study oil or a study incense that doesn't have rosemary in it, I don't know what's wrong with them, people. Science even recognized recently that it improves the memory 75% just by sniffing the shit.
Yep.
Shakespeare knew it.
You used to tell some of your students to just put it in their coffee in the morning.
I did.
And it's pretty tasty.
Well, I always say check with your doctor.
Yeah.
But there was a time when I was, you know, I was in a rush. I always did like rosemary tea and coffee before college. And I was in a rush one time and I didn't have time for both. I just tossed some rosemary into the coffee filter and brewed me up a batch of rosemary coffee. Mm-hmm. And damn, childhood memories came racing on, man. You combine the memory tonic with a stimulant and you're going to have an interesting time. You know, yeah. I got really good grades that semester too. But yeah, rosemary. Now, rosemary.
When I had my own herbal business going, one of my favorite and most quickest selling projects was a mental strength thing, and it was rosemary. And like two or three other things that all were for enhancing your study and enhancing your focus, and people like were shocked that it worked so well. Like, I made this because of my ADD, because it works and helps me focus when I'm overstimulated.
Oh, really?
I'm glad you like it.
That's
I'm glad
good.
You think it works.
So you find it helps on focus too. See? People don't talk about that enough. Makes sense.
Chinese medicine uses ginkgo leaves for brain power.
Yeah, she's got that in her, I think it was her incense recipe.
Yeah.
It was ginkgo and rosemary, and I forget what else.
Yeah,
I don't want to give away the whole recipe because you got to buy the book.
Yep.
Container Magic.
Yep.
Subtitle, I can't see shit in here. Spellcraft using sachets, bottles, poppets, and jars.
Yep.
Straightforward to the point. I would call it a spell book. There's a lot of stuff in here. It even says 100 plus spells on the back over here. Bags, jars, sachets, and more.
I mean, it is a spell book, but it's also there to give give some magical basics and exercises to help improve and enhance one's magical craft, because there's always something more to learn.
And I was going to hit on that because for years I always said that people don't do enough of the exercises. You know, my day, you know, you had some drawing down the moon and some Gardnerian books, and then spiral dance came along, and spiral dance was like revolutionary in my day, and it had all the basic stuff that you get in all the other beginner books, but half the book was exercises to make all of those things work better.
Mm-hmm.
And then not enough people spend enough time on exercising the brain and stuff that makes it all happen. So kudos to you.
No, I mean, one of the complaints I see people have is that I put everything together, I did the spell, but it didn't work.
Mm-hmm.
Did you actually direct the energy? What's that?
All right, well, we just got a couple minutes left, so you got websites you want to shout out, contact information, anything for the people out there?
You can find me on Twitter as at Charity L. Bedell, and I am on Facebook. I have an author page, and you can find my personal page, and I'm always up for answering questions or responding to any comments or thoughts people have. The more feedback I get, the better I can be as a writer and the better I can do in the future.
And I think you were saying you started a Mastodon page or something?
Yes, my publicist recommended it, so I'm going to start that. I'm going to start doing some TikTok work fairly soon. And I'm going to have all of that eventually, but right now, Twitter and Facebook are my primary social medias. I'm working on getting my reworking my Instagram for my business to be more about my author stuff. So,
yeah. Well, careful on TikTok. Shields up. You'll be fine. You'll be fine. It's a jungle out there. All right, well, Charity, it was a pleasure having you on again. We're going to see
you
at WitchCon, and then we're going to see you at Hexfest in person. Woo!
Yes, I'll have a chance to actually meet you.
Okay.
Yay!
Off topic, but have you been to New Orleans?
I have not.
That'll be fun.
It can do stuff to you.
I'm looking forward to it.
It can suck you in, man. I came here to do Hexfest in 2019.
And then we moved here.
And by 2020, we was moving
like,
here. By,
six months later, we walked into our home.
This town has got a power.
Yeah.
It's good. It's good, though. I don't know where you live right now. But
Maine, I think? You're in Maine?
I'm in Maine. Okay. It's the middle of a snowy winter land. It's actually snowing right now.
Oh, wow. Yep. Not here, but it's too
cold. We did have a tornado warning last night, which is fairly new for us. It's mostly hurricanes here. They didn't land.
And Hexfest is right in the middle of hurricane season, but so far, knock
on wood, it doesn't happen. Yep.
It's been good.
It's just really, really hot.
And the French Quarter buildings are really tough. They're never going to get damaged in a hurricane.
Yep.
So it's all good.
Yep.
Okay. All right. Well, we'll see you at WitchCon.
All right. I'll see you at WitchCon. Take care. It was nice talking
out.
To you.
Merry
you
meets.
Too.
Merry
Thank
part.
You.
Merry meet again.
Merry meet again.
Blessed be.
Blessed be.
Talk to you later. Okay. And another episode of Wittershins reaches its crescendo. You can find us, typically we broadcast on Wednesdays at least once a month. You know, sometimes we took some time off, but now that we started the marathons, I guess it's kind of a good thing that we did. We're going to run out of storage space anyways. Wittershins can be found on most places that you get your podcasts. If you can't find Wittershins on your podcast, actually Wittershins Radio, I did run into a band called Wittershins out there. Find some place else to get your podcast if it's not there, because they suck. Because we're fucking all over the goddamn place, man. And we can do this kind of stuff. If stuff's happening, we can go on the air whenever the hell we want, as long as we want, as many times we want, and do whatever the hell we want. Because, you know, it's anarchy over here at Wittershins, and we have a very large package. So I also keep forgetting to, you know, do self-promotion, because I suck at that. We also have launched Witchlens that we should plug every fucking time. But we launched, being that I spend so much time on TikToksic and other places, we saw the need for a place for our kind, to be amongst our kind. And, you know, we have enough problems fighting amongst ourselves without having to fight with Christians and other kind of crap. So we created our own social media app, and it's called Witch Lens. You know, like a magnifying glass or something, a lens, you know, Witch Lens. And it's thus far available on the Apple iStore. We are scratching and clawing to get our technicians to finish the Android launch. So if you have an Android or one of those Android platform devices, sorry, it doesn't work on there yet. We're really working on it. But if you have any kind of Apple product, an iPhone, an iPad, whatever you have, hopefully it works on there. But over there at Witchlands, so far, we're having a really good time. It's kind of limited. It's like Instagram in its infancy before you could do videos and all kind of stuff. It's like, you know, you got to post a picture and you make comments, put links, that kind of thing, respond to people, and that kind of thing. So it's got a long way to go, but we have improvements to make that we're going to make after the Android launch finally fucking happens. But check us out over there at Witchlands. It's a whole different world. Because the admins are witches, the people running it are witches, and we're not going to give you a community guidelines violation if you didn't violate community guidelines, and we're going to look at the person that accused you of violating community guidelines if you didn't violate community guidelines, because there's no bots checking our shit. It's me and Marta here. Got Uncle Birch, Aunt Marta, checking the shit on Witchlands. And if you step afoul of us, you will receive a boot in ass. Witchlands, available on the Apple iStore. So we'll be back. When's our, we have a broadcast tomorrow. Tomorrow, noon?
Oh, is that the one with Father Sebastian? Is that tomorrow?
Yeah, I think we said noonish.
It's noon his time. To our time.
You're right. Yeah. Thank you. So 2 p.m.
2 o'clock Central, yeah, noon Pacific.
2 p.m. Central. Tomorrow we will be interviewing Father Sebastian from the vampire community. And he's a character. Always love having him on. So check that out. There may be other people tomorrow too, but that's the one broadcast that we have scheduled so far. As always, you can find everything in the archives anyways. Wittershins Radio, we're going to play you one more, and then we're going to get the hell out of here.
Yeah,
Sebastian's
tomorrow.
We are stronger than before. We won't wait any longer. We are stronger. We have trusted no man's promise. We have kept to just ourselves. We have suffered from the lies in all the books upon your shelves. And our patience and endurance through the burning times and now have given us the strength to keep our vow. We won't wait any longer. We are stronger. Have grazed away the heather and have raised the sacred grove. You have driven native peoples from the places that they love. Though your greed has been unbounded, you have felt the pangs of shame every time you trod upon the mother's name. We won't wait any longer. We are stronger. Thought you had destroyed the memory of the ancient way. Still the people light the bale fire every year on Solstice Day. And on Beltane Eve and Samhain, you can find us on the hill, invoking once again the triple will. We won't wait any longer. We are stronger. Many races have risen and have gone, but dispersed among the nations of the world we linger on. Now the time has come to take the sacred cauldron of rebirth and fulfill our ancient pledges to the earth. stronger.